Hello.
So, how long has this particular journey been for you?
It's been long, the longest I've had to get this one made, because it came together and fell apart several times, and uh-huh. I had abandoned it, assuming that it would never get made, when my producer, Mike Ryan, emailed me. I was in Singapore doing a teaching thing, uh-huh. Said there's money, and I said, don't torment me, you know, I don't, it, look, if it's real, I'll be there, but, and it was real, and mm-hmm. so amazing, it really was a great stroke of luck that he had connected with a source of financing that could underwrite the film.
So is that how you survive between the films, is doing teaching
things like that? I'm a full-time teacher at NYU right uh-huh. now, and that gives a certain stability and security that working as a filmmaker of the sort that I mm-hmm. am does not provide. And there's a lot of material out there I could open myself up to. And I've read scripts. I said, oh, you know, this could make $100 million. I mean, mm-hmm. Perfectly fine, but the problem is I'm not interested, mm-hmm. and so I have to, and so I have fun teaching. I like teaching, and I'd rather do that than something that doesn't.
So what is that like for you? What is it? Are you teaching historic stuff or production?
Oh no, it's graduate students that are aspiring filmmakers, mm-hmm. and so I look at their work and give my comments on it.
Was it something you were ever interested in doing?
No, never thought I would ever in a million years do it. I never had any interest, but I found, I discovered, hey, this is a good thing. This is actually really fun and pleasurable, and I'm happy with that.
How'd they get you into it?
Well,
you graduated NYU, right?
I didn't actually graduate, but I'm friendly with people that, and so it came up at a certain
right.
point, yeah.
And you just jumped in both feet and?
Yeah, I mean, I had taught a semester here. I taught master classes, so-called. Uh-huh. And I had done teaching stints here and there. And this became a kind of formalized, but gave me the kind of security that I need in my life. I have a little one right now, and so I hadn't anticipated how costly that is, and so I really mm-hmm. need it now.
So are students what you expect them to be in this generation, or does it, I mean, you really are the, you know, a leader of the last generation, I guess, in coming up, at least.
If I was a leader, I wasn't aware of it, and I misled, because look where we are. I think that I look at my students, they're like 25 to 35, anywhere like that. They're young, they're smart, and some of them are very, very talented. And my heart goes out to them. I look at some of these works, I can see a film, oh, this guy's really talented, but how is he going to get money? Mm-hmm. How are they going to make a living? How are they going to survive? It's such a privilege to be able to make movies like this. I don't know. I just feel, when I look at them, it actually makes me feel really relieved. Thank God I'm not young anymore. It's so hard.
Do they want to make art, or do they want to make Armageddon?
Well, I think they're all types, but I think for the most part they're very serious and anxious, of course. How, uh-huh. you know, you get to a certain point. To me, you know, a 30-year-old may not be so old, but to a 30-year-old, you're already 30.
Yeah.
And you say, oh my God, I'm 30. Am I just a fool, an imposter? Is this all delusional, or can I really make a career out of this?
Mm-hmm.
And time goes by very fast.
It's funny because I was telling your publicist before that the last person we shot outside here at the Four Seasons was Werner Herzog, and he too has gotten into teaching.
Oh.
He has like his little teaching program out here.
Oh, he lives here?
He's lived in LA for the last number of years. He travels a lot, but
uh-huh.
he one of his homes is in LA.
Okay.
And he taught a program where I think he brought in pretty much anybody who didn't want to go to film school,
right.
to regular film school, but wanted to, had a passion for film.
Right. No, it's really it is heartening, but at the same time heartbreaking, you know, yeah. Because they don't know how little they know mm-hmm. about how all of this, the realities of all of this, and you have to live through it. But I like to be hopeful that somehow the cinema movies will reinvent themselves. Mm-hmm. And, you know, right now we're a little bit, as I see it, you know, in this year when they have these 3D movies coming out, that's mm-hmm. For me, it's a big red flag when movies start coming out in 3D. Mm-hmm. It's like an advertisement of desperation. It's like the 50s redux, you mm-hmm. know, and when they were panicking about TV. But I don't know what the solution is right mm-hmm. now, just to the economic strategies they have to continue enabling films like mine, mm-hmm. i.e. low-budget, independent-minded, non-studio films, to get made. If Claire Denis lived in the United States, she could make her first movie and then it would be over.
Right.
There would be no career. But we don't have that system here of subsidies. Mm-hmm. So for better or for worse, it's a market-driven society, and I'm as vulnerable as anyone else.
Do you keep up with the independent community in New York, or is that something of interest to you, or are you?
Well, when you say the independent community, you know, I don't know exactly where is that place. Is that a cafe? You know, I'm prepping and casting mm. something actually, and so I every time you make a movie, there are different people who are available mm. Because the cast of characters always has to keep changing because it's so arduous. You can't be at a certain point. You either move up or you move out.
Right.
And so I like working with fresh faces and different young people and so as long as I am making something, then I'm involved in that mm-hmm. so-called community, and I suppose also to the extent that I'm involved with my students.
Right, but you're not out going to cocktails and.
I'm not as social as perhaps it would. Maybe I should be. I have too many other commitments. I live a quiet life. I don't really go out very much.
Do you go to movies a lot?
I love going to the movies, but as you get older, you're a little bit more particular. Mm-hmm. Life is short and so forth, but I like to go to the movies for pleasure. If I see something on DVD, it's because it's homework. I'm looking for an actor or mm-hmm. I want to see what a cameraman did. It's purely for homework reasons that I would watch on a DVD. Really, I only watch in the movies.
And so this film is reflective of happiness, but is a completely new cast. So what was your process in finding all these different people? Because some of them were more famous, some of them less.
Right, it's every, it's a long story. I want to keep it entertaining for you. I'll say
truthful's
this.
Truthful's enough. It's okay.
Truthful. Yeah, that's a challenge there. I'm very happy. I'm thrilled. I love my actors, and I feel very fortunate and grateful that I was able to cast them, and that's the key. The key expressions that I was mm-hmm. able to cast them, and not have other more. Formidable box office names imposed on me.
Right.
But almost 90% of them have auditioned for me. So that's how almost all my movies are cast that way. I wanted, you know, in casting and recasting, that was sort of the fun, freeing, exciting mm-hmm. thing for me is that you can bring new color and shades and meaning and play with story in ways that you couldn't otherwise do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Paul Rubens plays John Lovitz's part, mm-hmm. And they're both funny sort of character people. But Paul Rubens, of course, has a whole other history. And a history that I felt actually lends a certain kind of poignancy and pathos to his performance that I couldn't otherwise achieve. Kieran Hines has a certain kind of heft, gravitas, weight, a heaviness that, you know, I needed for this kind of dead man walking, ghost-like husk figure.
So the evolution of Dylan in that case?
Well, so, yeah, I wanted, but Dylan, that's not Dylan, you know, as I, and so a Dylan, so I wouldn't be able to achieve the same thing were I to have Dylan come back. Right. He's a different kind of actor. So that's one of the, that's the kind of thing I could achieve by casting different actors. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I mean, look, if I'd cast everyone the same, I just the same actors. I mean, it would be a different movie. I wouldn't have had the freedom to change things quite so liberally as I did. There is a wonderful thing that happens though when you when you have actors return to the same roles, like in the Truffaut movies, Dwanel and so forth. Is that there's this very powerful but subliminal message of mortality as you see the actors age. It's very moving. But I chose to pursue a different strategy and one that instead would give me the freedom to really play and have fun. I mean, this is, after all, Paul Rubens, he's playing a character who probably actually has a Pee Wee Herman doll at home.
So you do seem from palindromes to this to have taken a turn in what's interesting to you. I mean, the whole issue of identity and, you know, what the character is seems to be, because in many ways Dollhouse was its own, Dollhouse and Happiness are in an odd way more traditional than the last two.
Well, I leave it to you to analyze, talk meta deconstruction. I'm not an intellectual here. I'm really, I tell stories, even if you want to take them apart and see how I'm doing this with the casting and that. Certainly in this movie, you don't have to have seen any of my prior work to follow the narrative. In certain ways, there's a plus, but there's also a minus to knowing and being familiar with Happiness.
Right.
Because on the one hand, while you can appreciate the way in which I play with the different characters and subvert and so forth, on the other hand, it makes you more self-conscious, depending on how familiar you are with locating the characters and so forth. Whereas if you don't know anything, you're freer in that way to take it on its own terms. And and I approach things on a very simple level, the level of as if I'm still 11 years old, if you remove the sort of social, political, sexual ramifications of the story, on a pure narrative level, even a child can follow the story. It's about story. It's a story and characters. That's what is always fundamental for me.
So, would you, if you had your druthers, would audiences see Happiness before seeing this, or intentionally not, or a mixture of?
It's so particular. It depends on the person. I don't know how people. I can't anticipate. I never recommend my movies to anyone. First of all. When I meet someone, they find out I'm a filmmaker. I just don't recommend anything because there are particular films. They're difficult. Maybe the sense it requires a certain sensibility. You need a certain kind of open-mindedness. And for the rest, I'm lucky that I have any audience. I don't say that with false modesty, I really mean it, and to the extent that I didn't know that I would be able to have one, that that I was from Dollhouse onwards, it was always a leap of faith, and I had to do so, I did something that I was invested in, that I believed in, that and I could only hope that others could connect with what I was doing, and that I was communicating something that of meaning to them.
Do you carry a weight from that? I mean, does your history weigh on you at all, or?
Well, it defines me.
Right.
I don't dwell so much on what I could have and should have and would have. I mean, that's an exercise in futility. Mm-hmm. But of course that helps you give direction to where you're going next.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, my next movie, it doesn't have any of these characters from any prior work.
Right.
And I very flippantly, I talked about how CAA, I think for the first time, likes my script, and I realize it's because there's no child molestation, rape, or masturbation in it. But that said, I don't know how commercial it is either.
Mm-hmm. Are you one to look back in terms of the work? I mean, do you?
I don't sit around and watch my movies. I mean,
do you turn them off if they come up on cable?
No, it's not that I turn off. Any director who has seen his movie has seen his movie 1,000 times in the cutting room. It's fun to see it with an audience when you finally have an audience. But then you move on. It's life. It's about moving forward.
Right.
It's not interesting to. For me to look at what I've done, I'm not interested.
So when storytelling happened in the middle of all that, were you a self-aware artist at that point? Was the drama around that movie part of the show, or at that point in your career?
There was certainly a certain amount of self-referential commentary there that I was being very playful with. I did have fun with that. I guess that was being a little meta.
It was funny seeing the red box mentioned in the New York Times without any sense that you would put it there, not the MPAA or something.
Well, I had to put. Well, if I hadn't put it there, we wouldn't have gotten the R rating.
Right.
I needed to, but I actually thought it actually kind of heightened things. I didn't have a. I actually felt, oh, the poor Europeans and South Americans and Japanese, they never will have the opportunity to have the red box, you know. I think supposedly there's a DVD where you can have watch storytelling and you press one button and you get the family version, which has the red box, or you get the adult version, which does not have the red box. So presumably, you know, the nigger fuck me harder is cool in the family version.
That part's okay. So, as long as you don't say anything.
As long as you've got a red box.
I think everybody's waiting still for the Vanderbeek version of the movie, though.
Well, that you know, the thing with James Vanderbeek, you know, is he's just the most well known, or almost, I don't know, of all the actors I've cut from my movies. Mm-hmm. There's not a movie I've made from which I have not cut an actor or characters, at least one. And it's one of my failings is I get a little bit ambitious. You always think when you write a script, you think it's genius perfection, and of course it's a delusion. But that's what helps gives you the courage to move forward.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, in the cutting room, you get a little bit unclouded. You begin to see what you really have wrought there, mm-hmm. and you discover what is it I'm doing. What is it really?
Mm-hmm.
And it's all a process of discovery, self-discovery, and it's endless as long as you continue making films.
Are you of the school of they have to take the film away from me, or do you finish your movie and you're done?
Oh yeah, no, I'm not. I have a sense of when I'm happy with it, I'm happy with it, and I couldn't stay. I don't feel ever that I'm deprived of an adequate amount of time to complete the film.
So, is there a time where you emotionally let go of any of the film? I mean, is there a time where you're kind of done and ready to go on? And
I'm always ready to move on. I mean, it's you're very passionately involved in figuring out and solving this problem of the movie and figuring it out and making it work. odd, but I don't take it personally. It's a strange, you know, and on some level I'm personally invested, on another I'm very dispassionate. So, you know, you have something that you want it to be beautiful and moving or funny, what have you. But you're always manipulating and conscious of how you're going to direct the audience and to look at this or that and then you figure out as much as you can and then you're immediately you want to move on to what's next.
Mm-hmm. So is this process fun for you, the press and selling of your movie, or you just kind of have to deal with it?
Well, it's a pleasure chatting with you. I don't know what it's very, I suppose you could complain that you're, you know, as having conversations at the Four Seasons, but I feel I'm fortunate that I have these problems to complain about if I do.
So do you feel like you, that Glee owes you a quarter every episode to, because of Dollhouse?
No. Glee, I think, is its own concoction.
Yes, that's true. But I mean, the impact of Dollhouse particularly, it's almost like there was nowhere anybody could go with happiness. No matter how much you love the movie, it's kind of hard to make that a point of reference. Whereas Dollhouse really became an iconic, specific thing that people have been referring to, or still referring to in films. Right. I saw a film that went to Tribeca. It was clearly a Dollhouse grandchild.
Yeah, Mean Streets, one of the terrible things about the movie is what an influence it had on so many young people, that there are so many terrible movies that try to be Mean Streets.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the unfortunate thing about this movie.
Mm-hmm.
I, you know, you always hope that your work, I don't make movies to inspire others to make movies. I make movies that I hope will engage an audience for those 90 or 120 or however many minutes,
right,
that for that period of time that an audience is transported to feel a little bit more alive, that connected to a world that, and then you go and have a nice dinner. I don't have any. If I can achieve that, to me, that's the best.
So you don't want to get into people's dinners? You don't want to make it hard to have that egg salad or whatever?
No, I like to imagine my movies are actually good conversation starters, or good for dates. In fact, you know,
mm-hmm.
that because it, you may be very awkward on a date, but if you have something like this, there might be a lot to discuss.
Have people come up to you with strange stories about their relationship to your films?
Well, people have come up to me, and it's always gratifying. People, you know, it's also something very good about humanity that a lot of people have come up to me and always said very nice things. But I know that there are an equal amount of people who really don't feel that way about me, but they've had the good discretion not to assault me. So I think that says something good. I people with all sorts of stories, funny, sad, wrenching, hilarious, really all sorts of stories. And it's incredibly gratifying to know you've been able to connect, because in a certain sense, what is the message of any movie is you are not alone.
Well, you certainly tap into people's worlds of kink and pain throughout the films. Is this something you research, or is it really just human behavior through a prism of your own? Or
there's not much in the way of research here. I mean, these are works of invention, and uh-huh. People ask often, is it autobiographical? And I could say, well, yes, but none of it actually happens. You know,
right.
it's emotionally so. I mean, pedophilia, for example. I mean, I have no inherent interest in the subject,
mm-hmm.
but as a metaphor for that which is most demonized, ostracized, feared, and loathed, it can't be B. And it's not about, and what that says about the limits of our ability to embrace or accept who we are as humanity, quote unquote, the way in which. We have both the capability for kindness and how it wages its battle against our capability for cruelty or evil is a constant moral quandary that we live through every day. that I think the movies all explore to some extent.
Do you have feelings about how people do react to different things? So it's, if it's the pedophilia section of Happiness, and there's laughter within it, because there is that something you're, as a filmmaker in the cutting room, you're going, okay, we have to hit the beat so we get the laugh?
You know, that's the thing, is that it's not so, you can't be so crass as to like, we got a laugh, let's keep it, we didn't get a laugh, let's cut it. You know, there's all kinds of laughter, and some of it I value and some of it is unfortunate. You know, years ago, I premiered Happiness at Telluride, and I remember a college kid who came up to me, a little bit drunk maybe, and he said, whoa, I loved your movie, it was just awesome. And man, I loved it when that those kids got raped. That was hilarious. And I knew I was in trouble. I knew that I had played with fire here. Mm-hmm. And which is why I said later that my movies aren't for everyone, especially people who like them.
If you have the bad taste of liking them, then you're probably the wrong person to be.
Well, it's a matter of speaking here. It's just the point is that they're very tricky, the way in which the dynamic of, if it's one thing if you see the movie alone yourself and alone in the movie theater, another when you see it with an audience, and some audience, they titter, they laugh at places that maybe you feel are inappropriate. Mm-hmm. And then a certain kind of judgment gets passed, is that from the filmmaker, is that the audience, is there a misreading, a misconstruction, what exactly is the intent here? Mm-hmm. And because it's so fraught with ambiguity, and I navigate such a fine line between the comedy and the pathos, it's always going to be a tricky dynamic.
But isn't it sharing it? I mean, I you referred somewhere to Todd McCarthy, I guess, seeing this picture alone in a screening room by himself, and that may, perhaps is why he liked it so much. But isn't the experiencing of sharing it with other people part of what's going on here?
Well, look, I'm not. I don't say that as a complaint. I say that really as a film very vulnerable to the way in which the audience engages with it, mm-hmm. and that it's a movie that whose response you have to it may very strongly be affected, mm-hmm. by the feeling you have about the way in which the audience responds.
Do you consider there to be a right way to?
I don't want to be prescriptive and say there is a way you must or should. In fact, I often introduce my films by saying the film is a very sad comedy. If you feel so inclined to laugh, feel free. Mm-hmm. And if you don't, that's also okay. It's a question of sensibility. That's a hard thing to evaluate exactly who has the right sensibility for this kind of work. But somehow my movies have found some sort of an audience, and it has somehow seeped into the world at large.
Now, there was a movie we showed was at Sundance, and subsequently didn't get distribution, even though it had a distributor buy it, and they never released it. It's called Raw Deal, A Question of Consent, and it's a documentary about a rape at University of Florida, that a stripper got raped, and the question of whether she consented or not. And we ended up playing at a film festival in Miami and had five different shows and five extremely different reactions. And when the audience felt that she was actually just a whore and laughed at her when she talked about the fear of being dead so that her kids would be left alone, they didn't want to talk to that audience. You know, they were so profoundly upset that the audience thought it was, you know, she was a laughing, that they had left her a laughing stock. It was kind of a stunning experience.
So why do you think the movie was never distributed?
It was Artisan, back when Artisan was around, and they claimed that it was because they couldn't clear music on the videotape that was shot in the movie, but there, some people feel like there was a lawsuit potentially, and it wasn't worth the trouble for them, and it was a... You know, unfortunate, because I think it's actually one of the most powerful movies you'll ever show. Particularly, like, college kids, I think all should see this movie, because it gives, at least gets them thinking about the idea of where the line of consent is. It's such a tough conversation for a 20-year-old.
Right.
You know, but it was fascinating. Some college audience had one reaction, and the late night audience had another reaction, and lawyers showed up to one show; they had a different reaction.
And all of that, and they still couldn't get they had all this excitement. They had a whole Well, you know, it every time I make a movie, it's always a different set of distributors. I see who's still standing. I mean, Sony Classics still there, hanging, playing strong. They have a formula, they have it down. But very few others are perennials, let's say.
Right.
It's such a volatile, insecure, unstable business, and things are so much grimmer now. One hopes that it's, of course, a cyclical thing. But like I said, I like to be hopeful, but I just don't know what I have of substance to support that hope right now.
Would you have any urge to just take out the old HD camera and shoot on a tiny, tiny budget and do all that again, or?
Well, you have to have the right material. You have to design it for that. You can't make a film on that scale unless you design it for that scale. If you have a movie that you've designed and that really needs a $3 million or $10 million budget, and you pretend that you have that budget and you don't, right, you're going to run into trouble. So it's like I always felt like the genius of the Blair Witch Project was that if they actually had more money, if they had a real budget, it would have been a failure.
Right.
That if it actually looked good, if it actually was shot in 35 and looked slick, and it would have lost all of its appeal.
Mm-hmm.
That the genius was in the concept.
So is the equipment made it better, the ease of equipment and the amount of it, or?
Well, I think that the great, you know, it's great, the invention, the technological inventions they've come up with, that it's like the typewriter being invented. It's making, democratizing access to the medium.
Right.
There are still going to be so many young people submitting to Sundance, I'm sure, every year, 1,000 movies, that because you can do so much with your home computer.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's all, I see that only as a good thing. And actually, one could even argue that it raises the bar. It was once enough to have a rags-to-riches story, that I could shoot a movie for $10,000 and that, oh my God, it's a whole feature.
Right.
It's sort of like when people said, oh, it's a movie with about a gay couple.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, oh my God, this is exciting. But now the bar has been raised. The movie actually has to be good.
Right.
The movie actually has to engage. And so in that sense, it's also a good thing. It forces one to have to be more resourceful and not get by just on the novelty aspect.
So do you like the mumblecore movies, or what they call mumblecore movies?
Depends on the mumblecore movie.
Right.
I happen to think that Andrew Bujalski is very, very talented, and he's the one I'm really most familiar with.
Hmm. So what's it like to be out here and then go back to work? The day job, is that a surreal experience?
Right now I'm going back to, I mean, I'm in the middle of casting and prepping a movie.
So you're
right
going to have time off of school this year? You're not going to go back?
Oh, I had to take the semester off to make the movie, yeah.
Okay.
So I took advantage of the press situation to do a week of casting here in L.A., and then I continue when I go back to New York.
And you're supposed to shoot in September?
October, really.
October, hopefully.
Yeah, yeah.
And then that'll be another year of your life?
I guess that's about how long I'm not. Yeah, something. I mean, I'll be teaching in the winter while I'm in mixing and so forth.
So have you done? Did you do that on this picture?
No. This was finished in 2009. Before the time
right.
was different.
So do you think it'll be odd to have your foot in both camps at the same time?
If it's odd, it's a good odd. I mean, to have one thing being finished, another thing starting, to have and to be able to have a steady job, those are good things in life. It's good. I feel very fortunate.
And a kid, you were saying, yes?
Well, I do. I have family, yes. So it's there's enough going on. I'm not, you know, it's all good. All these are things are good, and knock wood, you still have your health.